YouTubers, well, welcome to Star Trek Refit Prop Reproduction number 19, and I don't have that many fingers, so we'll skip that part. Interesting show, a little short video. What I want to do is show you the results of me repainting the Enterprise Refit after the mishap I had, and I want to tell especially the client, Michael, no worries. If anything, this has taught me to approach these kind of projects in a different way, and you will get a much more detailed project and a lot better Aztec detailing than I did before. This will be a multi-layer, and it's something that happens. It's an evolution that goes along, and everything worked along the timing that was set for it to happen. So, Michael, don't stress. It will be beautiful. I promise it will be beautiful, and it will be no less than beautiful. So, please. I know you're over there going, oh my God, what's going on? No, no, nothing like that. Nothing like that. Completely controlled. Everything's cool. Karma's all good. Okay, so got a few things to show you. These are actually Brett from Orbital Dry Docks masks that I now have. Big thanks to Brett for resupplying me with a couple sets. Because I know Brett wants me to have an honest shot at it. And being honest myself about the fact that I did not do them right, and yes, I had to eat some humble pie there, but you know what? If you're wrong, you're wrong, and you should admit it. You know, I hate people who will just sit there and keep telling you, you know, that they're right, even though you've proven them wrong 100 times over. That's ridiculous, and that's not the way to learn. So let's put that aside. Cool thing to show you, Mike Lippeth from Lipgnosis. I always have trouble with that, Mike. A wonderful graphics guy who does a lot of my graphics and things along that line submitted this to me. It is on parchment paper, just like a painting. It is Paul Tagliamonte, I believe, or Tag as he's known, digital painting of the professor. And I will soon have this puppy framed because it is so very cool. Some people have said I look like a mad Einstein. Others have called it the albino version of Howard Stern, other things like that. But gosh, thank you, Mike. So cool. Mike Lippeth, just a great friend. We almost connected in Chicago last time, but unfortunately, his daughter was visiting. The weather was not good, so it didn't happen. But we will get together one day, buddy. And Tag, wonderful. You do fantastic work, my friend. Let's see. So, one of the first things I want to approach on Orbital Dry Docks masking. Me and Brett talked about the instructions, and although they're not terrible, without the video, it's a little vague on the fact. And he admitted to me he needs to work on these, and thank you, Brett, for being honest about that. He needs to work on his instructions. My suggestion to Brett is, it's not so expensive, include a how-to video, or at least post a link to your video on the instructions as part of the instructions. And I think that will help a lot clear up any confusion with your mask. Because from what I'm looking at now and the fact that I've prepared my surface correctly for the application of these masks, I'm pretty sure I'm going to have a good success here. And again, Lou Dalmosa's masks as Aztec Dummy are very good masks as well. I don't want anybody to think I'm dissing those now in favor of Brett's. I think both of them apply depending on projects. There are certain things that dry docks I'm not saying capable of, but let's say I got Lou to make me up masks for the DeBoer's refit. Well, until Brett addresses those kind of kits and can do those, that is still my only source. And in some cases, I would prefer Lou's. I'm trying to be completely fair here because, yes, Lou's my friend and all that, but if there is a better mousetrap out there, I have to be honest about it. And like I said, I've strived to stay honest about this. And what has ended up doing it, and it, of course, until I actually use these and see what the results are, I think there's a place for both these guys. And I'm sorry if I ever indicated otherwise in the first place, but I've done a lot to make sure that my message was clear about that. So we'll leave it at that. The other thing, I noticed that Steve, and it's hot in here, guys, I'm not running the AC right now, so if I look all sheeny right now, forgive. Steve was addressing the fact about costs of building a refit and other things on his video that he posted today, Steve Neal, Steve Neal's Garage, in case you don't know. And I gotta say, look, guys, anybody that advertises a refit build for $2,500, It costs me more than that to make one the way I do it. What you're going to get, there's not going to be a top-notch product. I don't care what they say. If they write pro-built 100 times, it's not going to happen. My price range is anywhere between $12,500 all the way up to $30,000, depending what you want, depending how far you want it to go. When they start having lasers, they come in fancy display cases and all that, they easily get up to $25,000. May sound sick to you, may sound outrageous, but when it takes me 8 months of a year and costs me several thousand dollars to produce the piece, I mean, the cases alone can be up there at anywhere between $1,500 to $3,000. Lasers are $400 or $500 a piece, and there's usually two of them in there. The danger to my eyes is a fee you have to cover, because the lasers I use are not wimpy little pointers, and even those will hurt your eyes. You have to take into consideration, and of course the guys like us who actually do it as a living. You know, a good graphic artist makes $60,000 to $80,000 a year. If I make $40,000 to $50,000 a year, I'm happy with that. But if I'm working on a project strictly for you for that year, that's what it's going to cost so darn near it. You have to understand that. If you want to go and start, you know, even QMX for their models are charging $5,000, $6,000, $7,000, and they offer you financing. I'll finance you. If you're going to be honest and pay me every month and put down 10-15% down, and you're willing to wait the years, like right now I'm booked 3.5 years, and be patient about it, I will do you an outstanding job, and I will accept small payments. There's guys that will do it for less than I do. But if you got your heart set on what I do and you like what I do, then you're going to pay my fee, or, you know, we'll still be friends, but you ain't getting my model. That's the way it goes. If most of the guys that approach me want one or two pieces, and it's something they've had their heart set on since childhood. So to me, if it's a dream that you want to materialize into an actual thing that you've always wanted for 30, 40, 50 years, it ain't time to be price shopping like you're buying tires. This is an emotional need. It's not actual need, it's a want, it's a desire. You should go with the artist that suits your vision. You should look at all sorts of people's work and say, this guy's got what I want. And then the price is secondary. Yes, I'll negotiate up to a point, but I can't afford to give it away. This is my job. I've had a lot of people insulted on the phone saying, you're out of your mind, you know, you don't know what the hell you're doing and all that. You know what? I know exactly what I'm doing. And I charge according to what it is you want. I could do a simple basic thing for a little bit. I mean, I still build models for $1,500, $3,000 for something out of the box that's got some lighting, or static models that need a lot of work and all that, but, you know, aren't particularly difficult in my realm. $1,500, you know, $2,000, $3,000, and those are basic models. I really don't approach much these days for less than $5,000. Because most people want something lighted that's semi-complex. When you start getting up to 3, 4, 5 foot long models with every bell and whistle in there, my friends, there is a price. And anybody that offers you that for almost nothing, it's the old adage, you know, if it's too good to be true, it probably isn't. I actually did the mystery shopper bit for the first few years I was in business, an order from these so-called guys on eBay that were saying pro-built. And what I got was shameful. The most outstanding part of the model is usually the certificate, you know, which touted how great this thing was. And when you looked at it, you know, I've got one of these so-called pro-built, which was a Reliant from a fellow that I bought 8 years ago. And the only way to save it was to totally battle damage it and put it up in my rafters as, like, you know, basically an experiment. Guys, you know, collecting artist-made and especially known artist-made models or prop reproductions is not a cheap hobby. Don't contact us, guys. Think it's going to be $500 or $1,000. It's ridiculous. And it's insulting, and you getting upset about it just makes it worse for us. And the guys out there that are selling it for half what we sell for, that are good, and you know who I'm talking about, and making us look like we're overcharging, you're ruining the business because you know what it's worth. And frankly, don't whore yourself. There's no place for that in this business. It's an extremely demanding art form. And that's what it is, an art form. So just wanted to say that. So now we're going to take over a look over at the paint table, see what have I've accomplished with the refit. Blah, blah, blah. It's so hot, I need to turn the AC on for a few minutes and resume this film. So let's move on. All right, so here's our girl on the painting stand. This morning had a very successful application of Model Master Semi-Gloss White. Here's the little fella right here, about 12. I probably don't need all 12, but it's nice to have touch-up backup. The ordering number is 2143, and I got these at Tower Hobbies. I like Tower Hobbies because they got good prices, although, you know, 10 bucks shipping no matter what you buy can get on your nerves. So I tend to wait till I've got a fairly decent order. If it goes over 100 bucks, it's free shipping, so that's always good. You'll notice nice white coat. Sanded off all the Tamiya Pearl coat since it cannot be touched up in the primary color mode as it's laying it down and covering it up. Even if you use it as secondary color, if anything is glitched out, you can't touch it up. So I'm phasing that out as of this moment, as of now. However, as I was trying to tell Michael, no worries, you won't lose anything. Brett over at Orbital Dry Docks was super nice and sent me this lovely stuff, which is called Pearl X, P-E-R-L, capital E-X. This is the gold spectrum tone. He's also sent me the blue degree spectrum tone. And what this is just like if you have a bottle of Alclad, which is what I like to use for certain effects, if you let the bottle sit there for a while, it will collect the fragments, the metallic, the flakes, whatever you call it, on the bottom of the bottle. Well, this can be added to any color, and you'll notice it's the very same thing. But you can actually choose the spectrum and the intensity of the spectrum. So I'm very excited about using this, and this will go either into an extremely light camo gray, light gray, to add that metallic spectrum to it, or even a white. Again, you know, Aztec detailing is not a very pronounced thing. It's a very subtle thing with a sheen. One of the models of the refits I built years ago, the one with the blue lasers, had very pronounced colors, but that was a client's choice. He wanted it extremely pronounced and extremely obvious, and I built the specifications. It's not always up to me, kids. However, Michael, the client for this particular model, let me have a free hand at doing what I wanted to do. So I'm going for extreme accuracy as far as I can take it, within the budget set. This is not a cheap model. This is one of the higher end prop reproduction ones, so I'm doing my very best. So now next thing we'll do is we'll be using Orbital Dry Docks in pie slices. You can do entire sheet sections of it, but he's recommended not to do that because it can be done, but it's difficult. And I'm just as much a newbie as anybody else at this point. I'm using this product for the very first time. I have never used it before. I don't have historical experience to go by. So I'm going to approach it as a newbie and go very slowly and do my best. So we'll see how that works. But as you can see, the girl is pristine. Gosh, I wish it was just a white shit with nothing. Then I could just put decals on and call it a day. But no. Of course, you've got all the gray striping that goes along here. There's a lot of bluish colors over here. There's the sensor band stripes that go along the hull. We're still quite a ways away, kids. We got 2-3 months work left on this. So, you know, don't start about the prices of these things. They take hundreds of hours. The Enterprise E took me over 3,000 hours, and I'm not even going to talk about what that costs because that's the client's business. So, As I told you, this would be a short video. I'm just going over what I did recently and keep you up with it. A couple of things I wanted to go because I saw Steve's post this morning. And I was like, man, you know, people really need to understand this is not a cheap hobby. I mean, if you really don't like the price structures that some of us offer, build it for yourself and see just how difficult it is. And I'll leave it at that, all right? So next, we're going to do the Orbital Dry Docks masking on it and give that a whirl. And then the next video I'll post, I'll show the results. And just wanted to show you, and especially Michael, my client, everything is cool. We are back on track, and I'd rather go back 2 steps and make sure that the next 100 steps I take are going to be successful rather than trying to work with a dead horse. And dead horses smell, and that's not a good thing. So moving on, y'all have a great week, and we'll be seeing you soon.